Well, so I have to answer these questions. Okay, first of all, I'm a Vietnam veteran. I was a captain in the Army for 3 years. So my takeaway from the Vietnam War is that if a war is important enough to send one person, then you should send 1 million and win it. And if you're not prepared to send 1 million, don't send one. It's not worth fighting. And that's just a general criterion about war. It better be really important to have a war because wars are so serious. But the real answer to your question is, when I left Vietnam, and I've always felt that the North would conquer the South, and then the South would absorb the North, and the North would be irresistibly charmed by the South, which is exactly what happened. If you go to Vietnam today, you'll see an economic miracle. You'll see the people are just as lovely as they always were on both sides. And my wife is Vietnamese, and there are stories from her family where the North Vietnamese were very fair to her family who were in business. At one point, they took away a building and gave it to somebody else in the early days after the fall of Saigon, Ho Chi Minh City. And then her grandfather went and petitioned the government, said, "This is false. You took away my property." And they said, "You're kind of right. So we can't give you that building. We already gave it to someone else. We'll give you a different building." And that building became worth like $1 million. My wife didn't get any of that money, but her aunts and uncles in Vietnam share that building today. And that's an example of what happened in Vietnam. Okay, so there's one example. The other questions, some of them will be answered in the course of my talk. And you can revisit any questions I didn't answer at the end. How many of you were at my game talk about the first home computer? This is going to be a little bit different talk. This is a more serious talk about radical innovations that are going to transform the future and that are already making a difference. One of the things I want to say is that you are really privileged to live in one of the most innovative places in the world. Singapore is like rated 8th to 10th among the most innovative countries in the world, and for good reason. I mean, you have the Biopolis, the Fusionopolis. You can look outside and see the Titanic on top of those two sea level rising solution. You have all the water up there in case you can adjust. If sea level rises, you just pump the water to the top of those buildings. Is that what that's for? That's my joke. That's my standing Singapore joke. I look up there and say, "Hey, there's a solution to rising sea level." But no, there's so much going on in the city, and you can feel it, and you hear it, and you read about it. So this is a great place to do game design and technology design and medical research and curing SARS and diagnosing SARS and diagnosing viruses and things. So there's all kinds of things you can do here. Anyone can be an innovator. I'm a great example of that, and I'll tell you more about that in a minute, but if you want to be an innovator, you have to remember that the first rule of innovation is there are no rules. You have to keep current with innovation news. I read 36,000 headlines a year through push technology that delivers those headlines to my desktop. I scan them every day across 12 different parameters: space, energy, nano innovation, nanotechnology, et cetera, energy. And that's how you keep current, and that's how you innovate. You have to read science fiction and science news. I'll get back to that in a minute. You have to keep thinking about and dreaming about new ways of doing things and solving problems. And anyone can do this. I became an innovator. I was a kid from Oshkosh, Wisconsin, which is a very small town in the north central part of the United States. I grew up sitting on the bank of a river and bank of a lake fishing and dreaming about what I wanted to be. And at first, I wanted to be Ernest Hemingway and John Steinbeck. I wanted to write novels. So I became an English major, and I also was a journalist. So I basically studied literature and journalism in school. In April 1980, I went to this man. I had job offers from Apple and Atari. So I went to the Commodore, and I had come across some early game machines, and I fell in love with computers before they were really happening, and I kind of got access to some through a company I was working with. And so I went to this man, Jack Tramiel, the founder of Commodore Computers, the third personal computer company in the world, third ranking. And I said, I'd like to work for you. And he said, what do you know about us? And I said, well, I know that a lot of people seem to think you're some kind of a crook. But if you're not in prison, you're not a crook. You're just a shrewd businessman. And I'd like to learn how to be shrewd like that. And those were the words that convinced him. I know, I can tell you what I said because I practiced those words 45 minutes in front of a mirror, that exact little speech. And he didn't flinch or anything, and he said, what else? So I rattled off 20 things that I thought were wrong with the company. At the time, I had been a captain in the Army, so I'd experienced real war. I didn't know it at the time, but Jack Tramiel said that business is war. That was one of his mantras. I had also earned an MBA from UCLA, and I'd been a consultant in Beverly Hills, and I was all full of myself. So I wound up joining Jack as assistant to the president and marketing strategist, and I thought it was pretty cool. And I'm following Jack around the company, we're doing all kinds of things. And the first day with the company, we went to a meeting where Jack announced he wanted to do a small home computer, which turned out to be the Commodore VIC-20. Nobody else wanted it. Three people in the room wanted it. I was one of the three people. I argued passionately for it. When we came home, I put a 30-page memo on his desk with a happy face with a beard and mustache on it. And I told him that's everything should be done with a new computer. And he wound up putting me in charge of it. The second week after the meeting where he decided to do the small home computer, he went to Germany and he told the German government, you have to give us a free factory. No tax, no taxes, and basically a factory where everybody the factory was failing, and he said, we're going to take that over and make computers in Germany. And they said, why should we do that? And he said, because number one, I was an Auschwitz survivor, and you owe it to me. And the second reason is it'll be great PR for you, not to mention the economic benefits. And they said, yeah. So the first week with the company, we started the process of developing the first home computer. The second week with the company, we bullied the German government into giving us a free factory. Then we came home and Jack said, go look at the marketing department. I know you hate the marketing department. They had terrible marketing. And I went there and I found out all the software contracts had lapsed. They had no advertising. The promotional materials looked like it came from the 1940s. Everything was horrible. The user communities hated us. But we had one of the best computers. We had the Commodore PET computer. So I went to the marketing department, went to Jack, went to the marketing department, went to Jack, went to the marketing department, went to lunch, came back. All the marketing department offices are empty. So I went to the secretary, and she's writing. And I said, what happened to the marketing department? And she said, oh, Jack came by and fired them just before lunch. And I said, you don't seem bothered by this. Does this happen very often? And she said, oh, yes, actually it does. So the third week, we fired the marketing department, and Jack said, I'll hire a marketing vice president, and you go hire a marketing staff that you think we should have, and in the meantime, you're in charge of marketing. Now, don't you think after 3 weeks, and by the way, how many of you know the TV show MASH? Or the movie MASH. Okay, that's the movie. One of the characters in there in that TV show is a colonel that walks around, and he's got an orderly that walks around behind him with a clipboard, and everything he says, he starts a sentence, and the orderly finishes the sentence for him. That's how close they are. Well, I was that to Jack, so I would follow him around like a little meerkat, and I was pretty full of myself after all these things we did. But after the third week, we're walking down the hall, and I said something to him, and he turned around, and he glared at me, and he said, you're so green. And he said, you don't understand business yet. Business is war. You have to treat every penny as your own. You can have lifetime employment if you work at Commodore for more than a year, but lasting here a year is really tough, because we're tough on everybody. And that's what the situation Commodore was. But the coolest thing that happened was when he came to me and he said, you're in charge of the VIC-20. It wasn't the VIC-20, then the first home computer. You're in charge of making that happen. I told everybody in the company that they have to come to you and get approval for everything. So I fought viciously for full-size typewriter keys and ours and a telephone interface and cartridge games and software on cartridges and memory expansion and a voice module and game controllers and all kinds of things. And I made sure those things happened, and I became known as kind of a marketing father of the first home computer. It was $300. We called it the VIC-20. We call it the VIC-20 because the chip that was used was called the VIC, and 20 was a friendly number, and the reason I added 20 is because VIC sounds like a truck driver. So I said, we got to call it the VIC-20, and everybody just agreed with it. And nobody said, why 20? Doesn't it have to have meaning? I said, no, it's just a friendly number, and everybody said, even Jack said, okay. Along the way, I got to show William Shatner from Star Trek how to use his first real computer, because he'd never used a real computer until this moment. That's the first time he ever used a real computer. And he became our advertising spokesperson. And he sold it. And the VIC-20 became the first million-seller microcomputer of any kind. And I inherited a listing in Wikipedia. That's my legacy. I just want to say, 3 weeks ago, William Shatner sent me 3 copies of that picture autographed. I sent it to him, and I asked him if he would autograph, and he was kind enough to do that. He's 83 years old. He's busy. He's active. And yet, he took time to do that for me. Isn't that neat? So if you ever see Bill Shatner, I don't know how long he's going to be with us. He's 83. But always think fondly of Bill Shatner, because imagine if somebody who would do that sort of thing, what kind of guy he is off camera. Now, the reason I tell you that little story, and I had a longer version at my last talk at JCU a couple days ago, and you can access that through Professor Dillon. He'll make that available online, and you can see my slides in more detail. The reason I tell you is I'm an English major, okay? I was a journalist and an English major, and I wound up as a home computer pioneer. It means that anyone in this audience can be an innovation champion or an innovator just by buying the next new thing and staying current with it and being an early adopter. You help the process by telling your kids to learn science and math and doing things like with computers. You can help the process. And if you're a student, which many of you are, you can be an innovator. So I just want to make a distinction. There are inventors and innovators. Leonardo da Vinci was mostly an inventor, not an innovator, because most of his stuff stayed on paper. An inventor is someone who creates an idea or patents something or discovers something, but an innovator is someone who implements the invention or the idea or the discovery. The implementation to create commercial value is what we're talking about today. So we're going to talk about radical innovations that are changing the world. Well, radical innovation is an innovation that changes consumer behaviors and patterns of consumption. Do you think before Facebook came, anybody was thinking about, let's do Facebook? Do you think before smartphones got really, really smart, anybody was imagining that we'd all be sitting at the kitchen table looking across at our mom or dad or son or daughter or spouse and saying, will you put down that darn smartphone, right? Those are patterns of consumption and behavior that we do now that nobody was thinking of. That's radical. That's what we're going to talk about today. That's what I'm going to talk about. I'm going to give you my vision of the future. And the ideas I'm sharing with you are from my new book, which is called Innovation Rising, which is about radical innovations that are changing the world. And these are some of my preliminary thoughts before the book is actually written. I'm just sort of doing notes right now for it. Disruptive innovations are related to radical innovations because they replace everything that came before. And that threatens companies and demolishes industries and changes markets. We all know that. I would just point out to you something else. Today I was a judge of several small games that are appropriate mostly for mobile devices and computers, and they were based on retro things, and some of the games were simple and some were complicated. All of those games were pretty neat, and any one of those games that I judged today could lead to something extraordinary, and you may not realize it, but don't forget, all great things, all great innovations started really small. Everything that's really phenomenal that we see today had a light version, like a dietetic version when it started. And it was not impressive when it first came out. The first million-cellular microcomputer, which I helped develop, had 5K of RAM, which was approximately one page of typing paper, including the spaces between the letters. One page of typewritten text was all the memory that the first million-cellular microcomputer had. The first voice module, which I helped design for, and I actually selected the vocabulary, only had 256 words. Now, when you call somebody, when I got ready to come here, I called American Express and said, I'm going to be in Singapore. Nobody's stealing my card in Singapore. I'm going to, please let me buy things in Singapore. And I didn't talk to a human. A lady's voice, which was totally computerized, asked me a couple questions, and they said, okay, we'll register that. And that's the first time that's happened in 20 years. Okay. The first wave of unmanned aerial vehicles can only fly 30 minutes or less. So we all talk, you see all the magazine articles, the newspaper and TV things about swarms of drones in the sky. They're only going to be swarming there 30 minutes at a time. That'll get better, but not yet. The first regenerated human organ was a human bladder. I'll talk about that in a little while. Prototype hoverboards that levitate. You know, Lexus has created the Back to the Future hoverboard. You know that, right? How many of you know that? Okay, I'll show a picture later. That hoverboard is great, right? It only works in the park they created because it has to have super cooled nitrogen and other gases in it that make it work. So it doesn't really work everywhere yet. It works just in their little arcade area. Okay. The first sheets of graphene are smaller than postage stamps. We'll talk about that in a minute. So basically, welcome to the future. We're going to talk about the future now and what's coming. The next wave of radical innovation actually builds on platforms that we're all familiar with that happened in the last 30 years. Okay? We have all these different things happening, but you know, we've only had, in the last couple of decades, we've had GPS, wireless, broadband, gene therapy, the human genome was mapped and sequenced, and all these different things. We have high throughput screening. We have the first people who were given regenerated organs from stem cells are still alive, and all those things were wireless, anything you can think of. They all seem to have one or two words, you know, wireless communication, broadband, GPS. They're all pretty simple. They trip off the tongue. All those things now are being converged and systematized. Almost everything that's being developed now is a little bit complicated, and it either involves the convergence of those things I just mentioned or systems based on those. It's hard to do those kinds of innovations in a garage. This is called a sense-making framework. I was at the Wharton School for almost 20 years, and what we did, I was managing director of a program that studied best practices and strategies for developing and exploiting and marketing radical innovations. And we worked mostly with companies, not so much with students, but mostly with companies. And we worked with companies like Procter & Gamble. This is the most elegant and simplest sense-making framework that describes the innovation process. There's a gentleman named Larry Houston, who is the vice president of innovation at Procter & Gamble. And he asked me, he came to Wharton and he started developing some ideas there, which they formalized into a strategy called Connect and Develop, which is how Procter & Gamble developed their innovations. But he invented this little framework. And all it is he asks what's needed and what's possible, and he does fact-finding in between. So let's look at some factors that expand possibilities. If we want to decide what's possible and we don't know what's possible, here are some places to look. You can scale something. You can make something larger, smaller, stronger, thinner, faster, or slower, or whatever is needed there. You can do place shifting, workers working from home, on the train, anywhere. Now we use mobile devices. The stock market in the US crashed this week, and I made some decisions. I didn't bring my cell phone. I didn't bring a laptop. I had an iPod. The iPod was here to use for music on the plane, and I put a movie in there that I didn't think would be on the plane, a horror movie. And my wife said, you can use your iPod in Wi-Fi. So she just did a couple of clicks on my iPod, and I used my iPod to respond to this market crash in the US, which is amazing. That's place shifting. I wasn't home. I wasn't at a stockbroker's office. I wasn't doing anything in the US. I'm in Singapore, and I'm making decisions back in the States. You can do time shifting the same way. My wife and I don't watch TV commercials. Not because we hate TV commercials, but because we record all the TV shows and we watch them a day or two later. We save them up, and at a night when we want to have a nice meal, we grill something on the grill outside, and we watch all of our favorite shows, and we scroll really fast through the TV commercials. So we almost never watch TV commercials. Does that change the model for TV advertising supported content on television? You bet it does. Changing patterns of consumption and consumer behavior. Mr. Business School guru, this is how we think about innovation, right? And you teach this. At JCU, you can learn this at JCU. It can be. This stuff is taught. Solution, you know, so obviously solving problems, at making things cheaper, technical barriers, et cetera, science fiction and all that. Of course, radical innovations create value. By the way, I have more content on my slides than I'm going to talk about. You can see these online afterwards. I always put more content on because people who couldn't make it here, you know, wouldn't you rather read this slide with some facts on it than just reading a slide that said, radical innovations create value, and then you didn't know what I said. So there's a lot of content on my slides, just want you to know that. And here's some examples, you know, robots companies and small unmanned aerial vehicles and 3D printing and smart robots. Those are all multi-billion dollar markets by 2020. That's the economic value being created. The most commonly used phrase at the Wharton Business School in the United States where I worked is, what's the value proposition? I heard that phrase almost every day for 18 years. I'm not kidding. Anywhere and anything we did, people were asking, what's the value proposition? Not always money, but value. The other phrase that I heard most often at Wharton was, what's the big idea? Here are some issues, what we call critical issues, drivers of innovation, but they're really kind of critical issues. You know, the concept of productivity, this is something that really bothers me, and I'm writing about it in my book. I call this concept neo-productivity. In the past, the concept of productivity was to improve the use of talent, time, and resources to make humans, to extend the capabilities of human workers, right? To make us more efficient as workers. Unfortunately, today, because of the economic stress, economic situations, and the need to grow things, and the dearth of innovation, productivity is almost being redefined as a way to use technology to eliminate human workers. And that's happening a lot. And when there used to be a human worker sitting at the telephone, ask, hello, sir, you're going to Singapore, we'll register that. And this time, a robot did that. That's kind of spooky. This has to do also with the issue of the wealth gap that everybody talks about. this kind of thing is creating that wealth gap and making it continue. We have to do something about it. We have to use technology to create more jobs. There isn't enough thinking being done about that. The other thing is, there are no secrets. Do you guys know, guys and gals, do you know that virtually every agency of the US government was hacked into and all their data stolen in the last year? My cadence when I just talked, that's how a comedian, that one of my favorite comedian talks. Do you realize that? That's true. The CIA, the NSA, the Joint Chiefs of Staff, the White House's email, the Joint Chiefs of Staff military of the US was unable to use their email for the last 3 weeks because it was hacked. And it may have been hacked and looked into for the last 2 years. And this week, North Korea started firing artillery shells at South Korea. Is there some relation between the two? It's very serious. And all of you who are in computer technology or IT or business or government, something has to be done about this because it can't continue. Another thing I want to talk about is near and dear to the heart of many of the leaders in this part of the world, and that's innovation at the bottom of the pyramid. I had a dear friend named C.K. Prahalad who wrote a book called The Fortune at the Bottom of the Pyramid, and he gave his first lectures on that topic at Wharton, and we published his book. He died of cancer a few years ago, but his legacy lives on, and I want to make these comments in his memory and to his spirit. Because he said, what India doesn't need is a whole bunch of 2-liter bottles of Coke. What India needs is 1 billion 5-cent bottles of in returnable glass bottles of Coke. And he said, the person who sells those billion bottles, the company that sells those billion bottles is going to make a fortune. Okay? We have to think about the bottom of the pyramid. The bottom of the pyramid doesn't mean we innovate and we solve problems and we do technology just for the people who are less fortunate in the world outside the industrial sectors. There were some really smart people in Africa. Mo Ibrahim and some other people started a company called Saltel in Africa. And before he wirelessly networked Africa, if you wanted to call from one African capital to another, you had to route. When the old wire lines were in, you had to route the phone call to Belgium or another European country to go from one African capital to another by phone and talk to somebody. And now most of Africa is wired, is wireless. And if you look at any documentary about Africa today, you'll see people walking on dusty rural streets talking on cell phones, which is kind of a miracle. That's an innovation that was not an innovation here in our part of the world, but it was an innovation when it was brought to Africa. Look at this picture. What's wrong with this picture? That's Africa at night. Compare Europe to Africa. There isn't even lighting and electricity in most of Africa. It's still the darkest continent. What's wrong with that picture? Look at this picture. This is disturbing. These are very wealthy people with swimming pools there, and these are people living in slums right next to the tennis courts, and they have trouble getting clean drinking water. What's wrong with that picture? That's why we innovate. Well, some people are trying to make a difference here, and the president and vice chancellor of JCU, Sandra Harding, is leading the State of the Tropics Initiative, which involves more than a dozen research institutes, studying and recommending solutions to the tropical band. Okay, why is this important? Am I just saying that because I'm in the tropics? No, I'm saying that because in 2010, I earned a master's degree in environmental studies. My thesis was the paradoxes of global warming. Okay, I'm a champion for global warming. I'm not a champion for it. I'm a champion for fixing it. But think about it. Do you know what we talk about in the United States and Europe? Do you know what we talk about? Oh my God, the United States and Canada and Europe, we're gonna become tropical. And the malaria mosquitoes are gonna migrate north. Oh my God, we're gonna get all these diseases and things and tropical things. And we're not ready for it. And our crops are gonna be attacked by tropical insects. Oh, horror. Well, what the heck is going to happen to the tropics? The tropics going to become deserts and flooded and uneven climate patterns where some places are going to be flooded and have horrible rain and rising sea level and island nations disappearing and stuff. Who's talking about that? Not the industrial countries. It means the tropical banned countries have to start addressing these things themselves. It's not going to be solved by stopping China from building one coal-fired plant every 2 weeks and polluting the air. There are other things that have to be done, and the tropic banned countries have to start taking responsibility and lobbying for more solutions. I don't have all the solutions, by the way, I'm just raising the flag. This is Anita Gold. She's a friend of mine. She just won $1 million X Prize for developing a gene therapy chip, but she also has a portable diagnostic device she developed that you can take to rural countries, rural areas, remote regions of the world, and diagnose disease without a doctor. And you can create a lot of social benefit by having something as simple as that, and she's devoted her life to that. I sit on a committee with her in Washington. This is, okay, so let's talk about what's possible. This is the fun part. This is the most fun part of my talk. This is where I get to put on my futurist hat and look at what's coming or what's here already, okay? This is the fun part. I love reading about this stuff, writing about it, sharing it, getting you all to think about it. Robots rising. There are more than 9 million robots in the world. Most are industrial. But the U.S. is going to sell, North America will sell, North American robot companies will sell 14,000. They sold 14,000 industrial robots the first half of this year. 14,000 industrial robots were sold by North American industrial robot companies. Now, the problem is, a lot of people say, robots are fine in factories, but they'll never become relational. They'll never be able to talk. I beg to differ. See that guy? How many of you know Pepper? Anybody know Pepper? One, good for you. Pepper is a robot developed in Japan that has the ability to recognize faces. And when they decided that it could recognize faces and they got that technology pinned down, they said, how about if it could recognize faces and then learn to recognize emotions? So Pepper is now actually, it's on sale. And it's advertised as a robot that can learn to recognize emotions and respond to those. You know, in the movies, we all have seen the science fiction movies, right? Where the robot comes up and says, Professor Dillon, are you feeling okay today? You look sad. That exists today. Is that scary? Actually, Professor Dillon is seldom sad. I should have said, you look delighted. What are you happy about? Because he's always smiling. But look at this. There's a traffic robot in the Congo, in the middle of Africa. What the heck? I just discovered that a couple of days before I came here. I stuck that real quick in my presentation. I couldn't resist that. Isn't that cool? That's the best. Here's one that's a little far-fetched, hard to believe it's going to happen. This is an elderly assist robot in Japan. They claim this will help people get in and out of bed and so forth. I don't know if I trust that thing to like help me in and out of bed, but they're working on it. These are in China. These are server robots that are supposed to replace waiters and waitresses. Remember my slide on neo-productivity? That people are using technology to replace humans? It's kind of a sin, I think. By the way, I didn't think that 20 years ago. I thought, oh, technology, it's going to make us more efficient. We're going to have less workers. Now I've changed my mind. I actually think differently. How about drone servers in Singapore? I have some really neat Singapore slides too. I found some really neat innovations in Singapore. I thought that would be cool. So this is, here's your prime minister looking at the inaugural launch of the Infinium Serve prototype during National Productivity Month. Hopefully we won't replace too many waiters and waitresses in Singapore with that. It's pretty crowded. I think it's pretty crowded in some of the restaurants. We were at La Passat the other night. I don't know if these things could negotiate among the crowd, and I think we're going to still need human servers. I can't see those things serving my chili crab. I just don't. Would you like some sauce with that, sir? Some buns to sop up the sauce? I don't see that. Driverless cars in Singapore. Okay, every single auto company has to be what I call multidextrous. Ambidextrous, you can play piano with both hands, right? Ambidextrous, or type with both hands, write with both hands. Ambidextrous means a company studies things that are existing that they can exploit, and they also study high-risk, high-reward things they can explore. Okay, that's ambidextrous. Automobiles, all automobile companies have to be multidextrous. Okay, they have to keep selling gas guzzling cars. At the same time, they're working on electric, hydrogen, driverless, solar, all kinds of other kinds of vehicles. So these kind of smart cars are being developed, and we're going to have driverless cars at some point, but they're probably going to be in special lanes. Which, what's the difference between having driverless cars, like 4,000 driverless cars driving in a special driverless car lane, or having a subway doing the same thing? I don't know if that's going to really happen. I don't get driverless cars yet. Besides, I saw a really nifty video of a reporter that was asked to stand in front of the driverless car. The driverless car came in after crossing the whole United States without an accident. The driverless car came in, stopped right here, and knocked the reporter off. And they said, "Oh my God, we forgot to set it on urban. It was still set on rural," whatever that means. And the video shows the reporter going flying in the garage and picking himself up like that. I don't think he broke anything, but I can never get that out of my mind. That's like, ugh. So driverless cars. Okay, here's a good one. I live between two cities, not far, like 4 or 5 miles. But I'm just outside the pizza delivery zone from both cities. I can't get a freaking pizza at 10 o'clock at night delivered to my home because I'm just outside the zone. So I hope that happens. That'd be nice. The problem is they only last 20 to 30 minutes at a time. They interfere with airspaces. People are worried about invasion of privacy. You don't know if it's delivering a pizza or taking pictures it shouldn't be taking or carrying a gun or a bomb, okay? So that's kind of scary. But these are some drones being experimented with in Singapore. Okay? Drones are pretty cool. Now, what I think is going to happen, here's my view on it. I think the first drones are going to be used in places where they're needed to be stationary, but they need to be up high. And they will be tethered to power cords. And they don't have to last. They can then last forever up there. They can stay up there until the rotors give out or the weather changes. So I think we're going to have tethered drones, which is very similar to dirigibles, which used to fill the skies in the 1920s. Isn't that weird? Going back to instead of dirigibles and big commercial balloons, we're going to have little flying quadcopters and octocopters on tethers. There's only one problem with that. They can only go as high and stay lofty and go around, and then as long as they're big enough to support the weight of the cord, which weighs a lot, and you can't put a little, it's not like a thread that's tethered to them. It's a heavy electrical cord. So that's a little bit not quite feasible yet. The other thing that's going to solve some of the problems with drones is they're going to create aerial corridors where aircraft don't go, but drones can go, and that's how they'll solve the problem of are these drones going to stray? But some of the drones are going to, guess what's going to happen to some of the drones? What's going to happen to some of these drones? Think about the Internet of Things. If you create an internet where the internet is connected to all kind of things that can communicate wirelessly, what are people going to do to them? What are people going to?
They're going to hack them, and they're going to let them do silly things.
Absolutely. I could have asked any one of you in the audience, and you would have said that. So we're going to have hacked drones. Okay? So we have to, how are we going to fix that? That's what innovation is about. Somebody out there has a solution for that. Okay. Singapore is what I call a smart city. I'm so impressed with Singapore. That's one of the reasons I came here. I'm not only coming here because I love the JCU, the university, and my friend Roberto Dillon, and a lot of other good things happening here, but I love the city of Singapore. I love Singaporeans. I think you have a wonderful, just a terrific spirit, you know, as a people and as inhabitants and as a multicultural society. This is my kind of place. So, when I think about Singapore, I think about Singapore as being one of the first smart cities. You may or may not agree with how things are administered or how fines are administered or how the social engineering happens, but it's a really smart city. Okay? And it's going to get smarter. And that's pretty cool. It actually functions beautifully. One of the most civilized cities in the world is what I told my wife when she asked me where we're going. I said, we're going to one of the most civilized cities in the world. Really cool, innovative cities. So what's a smart city? What's coming? How would you define a smart city? A smart city will have net zero buildings. How many of you know what a net zero building is? A net zero building uses a certain number of energy, but also produces enough energy that it flattens out to zero. It takes in and puts out the same amount. So it has solar panels, architectural, wind turbines, and things like that. It generates no waste. All the waste is utilized inside the building. It captures rainwater and so forth like that. It's a net zero building. There aren't many of them, but there will be more. We're going to have more vertical farms. If you think the cloud forest is cool, why isn't there a cloud farm in Singapore? You can grow you can grow enough crops to feed huge numbers of people in a vertical farm. The way you do it, you put the cattle on the top, you put the light using crops on the outside, you do the food processing centers on the inside, and you put the shopping mall that sells the produce in the basement. Okay? That's called a vertical farm. It's a very simple model. But not many people are doing it. And of course, we'll have more electric and driverless vehicles, and we'll have aerial drone delivery networks. We'll have aerial drone delivery networks. We'll have also, I think we're going to have charging networks. I think at some point, how many of you have a device on you right now that needs to be charged at some point? Okay. Don't you think at some point we should have universal charging networks? So every seat that you're sitting in here, you could plug in anything. Maybe it's USB, maybe it's some other interface, but at some point we're going to have universal charging where anything can be charged or recharged. And of course we're going to have ubiquitous sensors, which is the Internet of Urban Things. Everything's connected to the internet. You know, I know a company in the U.S. they manage restrooms. And they're responsible for changing the toilet paper and resupplying that and the hand towels and all kinds of other supplies in the restrooms. And they used to put these on weekly routes where people had to drive trucks around. Sometimes a truck would come up to a restroom in a McDonald's and find out they didn't need any toilet paper. He just wasted his visit, and he'd come out very, very unproductive. So now they have sensors all over the restrooms, and they report which stops the truck has to go to that needs more toilet paper or napkins. Here's some medical innovations that are actually happening now. I happen to know the pioneers that are doing all of these. They're personal friends as a result of a book I wrote. Proteus Digital did the first ingestible computer on a pill. This is a computer chip that you can swallow and it'll be digested. When the pill enters your stomach, the acid activates it. It sends some data to a little tab that you wear on your wrist, which in turn communicates to the internet wirelessly to tell somebody that something's, that the person in the clinical trial just took their pill, that an elderly person took their medicine and didn't forget or needs a phone call to remind them, or that there was some reaction to the pill that needs to be monitored. It's pretty cool, and that exists today. Organs on a chip, that's a lung on a chip. This is done by Don Ingber, who's a guy who has an academic who has a team that's doing organs on a chip. They have a small number of lung cells that act just like a lung, and they use that to test pollutants and lung cancer cures and things like that on just a few cells. And guess where they get the cells from? Cancer patients. So you don't have to flood the patient with a drug that might or might not work, and if it doesn't work, try a different drug and a different one. That's not good. So they grow little small pieces of lungs on a chip. It's pretty neat. This is the one of the first replacement organs. 10 years ago, Dr. Anthony Atala at Wake Forest Institute developed the first artificial bladder. He used a Hewlett-Packard inkjet printer to spray human stem cells onto a scaffold, and he made a human bladder, and he implanted it in a young girl whose bladder was diseased. The young girl graduated from college 2 years ago. Now he's working on denser organs. The denser organs are harder to do. So what they're doing now is taking cadaver organs, decellularizing the organs, which leaves a protein matrix, a structure in the shape of the organ, the heart or liver. They then repopulate that organ with stem cells, which somehow magically conform to their function and location in the organ. It's very spooky how it happens, but they seem to know where to go and what to do. Okay, how many of you know what 3D printing is? Okay, well, everybody knows what 3D printing is. How many of you know what 4D printing is? Okay, so I'll teach you something today. 3D printing, you know what that is, right? You create something using software. It means you can put something on a computer and have a 3D printer make it out of plastic or plastic and metal. You can even make batteries out of metal and plastic combined. That's 3D printers do that. And you can have that done in another city, another country, or on Mars. And you're looking at the person who told the chief technology officer at NASA a few years ago that he should start looking at 3D printers, and today they have an open innovation competition on the internet for the best use of the 3D printer on Mars when the first colony is sent there, which is really cool. And I was one of the people pushing for that and promoting that, and they were saying, what are we going to use 3D? Why would we need 3D printers? I said, you have to, and here's why. And now they have a whole program about it. It's pretty neat. So that's why I call myself an innovation champion. I don't take credit for it. I wasn't the only one talking about it, but I raised the flag and I call it to their attention. That's all I want to do. I want to help make a difference. This is, you can 3D print food. Okay? You can put materials in and you can 3D print food. Why is that important? Because it's hard to take a big chunks of cheese to Mars when you have to travel 18 months to get to Mars when the first humans go there. Do you think they're going to take big chunks of cheese with them so they can have a pizza when they land? No. They're going to want a generic powder that they can flavor into they can make into pizza or pasta. Okay? And that's going to happen because it's being experimented with right now. How many of you know the Lytro camera? It's an infinite focus camera. You take a picture with the camera, it captures the whole light field. It means after you take the picture, you can refocus it. This is the same picture taken with a camera, after they took the picture, they focused on the flower and they focused on the girl. That's an infinite focus camera. I was a photojournalist when I started my career. I was a newspaper journalist. That's how I started out. And so I love this. I can remember worrying about depth of field. If I took your picture or your picture or your picture, I had to worry about, are you going to be in focus? Is there enough light? How far in focus? Just your glasses or your whole head? I don't know. So that's what, so now this is cool. Okay, how many of you think you're paying too much for ink cartridges for your printer? Yeah. That's all? Everybody else? You must be rich or you don't use printers, okay? Because they cost a fortune. And there is a problem. Remember I said one of the drivers is problem solving? Guess what? I couldn't believe it. I just read a week ago, and I couldn't wait to put this on a slide. Epson Sickle created a printer that sells for under $400 US, that's on sale in September, that has ink cartridges that cost $13 US, and each cartridge set processes 4,000 pages. So $13 for 4,000 pages and it costs $4. That's a game changer. Is that a radical innovation? Is that a disruptive innovation? How would you like to be making the Canon printers and not own the patent to this and have to sit there with your $50 a cartridge inventory saying, well, you know, you really need these $50 cartridges, and you can buy this whole printer for not very much at all. Is that cool or what? I bet I just sold about 10 of those. I should get a commission. Okay, this is a book I wrote. It came out in December 2014. It's called Nano Innovation, What Every Manager Needs to Know. I was very fortunate to be a journalist when I was younger, so I went around with sort of a... I also type 85 words a minute, so I could interview people and I could type as they were talking, and I just typed everything they said on the phone. I interviewed all the nano pioneers, and I came out with what's kind of the most authoritative book on nanotech innovations. These are some things from my book. Nano innovation, the ability to view and manipulate nanoscale structures allows us to use atoms and molecules like Legos. Everybody needs to know that now, but we don't teach that very much in our schools, but kids need to get, you know, we need to put this in our schools now, and I'm championing that. I'm on an initiative in Washington to review the National Nano Technology Initiative, which is a $1.5 billion program in the U.S., which sort of jump-started the nanotechnology innovation process, and I'm sort of on the committee reviewing that and making recommendations, which I'm very honored to do, but that's how you make a difference. President Obama was the first world leader to have a nanoscale portrait. This is made out of carbon, a forest of carbon nanotubes, and the number of carbon nanotubes is almost the same as the number of votes he got in the election. Isn't that cool? What an interesting bit of trivia. All atoms are nanoscale, which are under half of a nanometer. A nanometer is a billionth of a meter. It doesn't mean much, but if you know that all atoms are nanoscale. The very first manipulation of atoms was the creation of the IBM logo by Don Eigler, who won the Nobel Prize. Nano innovation is not new. What do you think about nano archaeology? A lot of things were discovered using nanotechnology that we didn't understand. This is me in the Yucatan. My wife and I go to the Yucatan every year. That's called Mayan blue. That's 500-year-old paint. How many of your houses or anything that you painted lasted 500 years that you know of? Probably last 10 or 20 years and they have to be repainted, right? 500 years, that paint. That's because there are nano-sized pockets in the clay where the pigment went and resided, and that locked that pigment in so it doesn't decay. And that's something they discovered. They wondered why Mayan blue paint lasted 500 years, and that was the reason. If you go to room 51 in the British Museum, you can see the Lycurgus cup, which was made in 400 AD. If you look at it by shining a light from the outside, it's green. If you shine a light from the inside, it's red, because there are gold nanoparticles infused in the glass, and the gold at the nanoscale is red. One of the reasons is the nanoscale is too small to see with an optical microscope. The visible bandwidth of light is 200 to 600 nanometers. And the nanoscale is 100 or less nanometers, which means you can't use an optical microscope to look at nanoscale images. And that's important because viruses, protein fibrils, DNA are all nanoscale. So how do you look at that stuff when the processes that cause and cure disease are changing over time and you have to watch it? Well, some scientists developed something very cool. They developed something called a nano lens made out of metamaterials. They took nanomaterials and they made a lens out of it, and it literally magnifies the nanoscale things so they can study it. And they've developed a lot of interesting cures for diseases as a result of that. Here's some other interesting nano-related things. Flexible electronics come from nano. This is a stretchable electronic skin. Every single electronic gadget, gizmo, device you use is enabled by nanomaterials and nanocircuits. All semiconductors have nanocircuits. Almost all materials that are used in cell phones and smartwatches and things like that use nanomaterials. Okay? Moore's Law. Moore's Law means that computing power doubles every 2 years or so. And so basically, all of these circuits are nanoscale. This was one generation to another. One of the things they did was pack more in, but they also took a structure that looked like this, and they turned it vertical and raised it up, and they created more space that way. So Moore's Law is going to continue for a while longer. IBM just announced the development of a 7-nanometer semiconductor architecture. Intel's working on 10 nanometers. When we hit 4 or 5 nanometers, the electrons don't flow through the channels properly. And then we hit the wall, and we have to find other more creative ways to continue the expansion of computing power. Here are some things, these are some rare biological pictures. This is the West Nile virus. This is the Huntington protein that's a mutation that causes Huntington diseases. Those fibrils are nanoscale. This is one of the clearest pictures ever taken of a strand of DNA, which helped to prove that the DNA is actually made from a double helix, and it actually proved it visually. This is a sheet of graphene. How many of you know what 2D materials are? 2D materials are materials made from one atom thick of that material. Carbon. If you take carbon and you make a sheet of it, one atom thick, it looks like chicken wire. It's configured like chicken wire. But it's flexible, it's transparent, and it's stronger than steel. It's also brittle. It's also difficult to make consistent because it'll have flaws in it. But people are trying to figure out how to manufacture that. That's what it looks like, and that's a sheet of it. This is a sheet of carbon. Carbon's black, right? Does that look black? One atom thick, you can see through it. That's a sheet of graphene bonded to a sheet of plastic, and it's crystal clear. There are other 2D materials. Tin is called, carbon, 2D carbon is called graphene. Tin is called staphene. If you take a sheet of silicon and make it in one layer like that, one atom thick, it's called silicene. That's how you describe it. Another thing, by 2030, we're going to run out of rare earth materials. Rare earth materials are used in everything that we hold dear. Solar panels, smart devices, large screen TVs, anything electronic, any semiconductor uses these rare earth materials. What country produces and is home to most of the rare earth materials in the world? Anybody? China. What is China doing with its rare earth materials? Limiting export, raising the prices. what's going to happen to nanomaterial, rare earth materials when we don't have any anymore? We have to take nanoscale materials, which have different properties, and use nanoscale versions of earth-abundant materials like carbon and silicon, and use those to replace rare earth elements. It's a major application for nanotechnology. These are some friends of mine. You know, for 30 years, by the way, I love geckos. When I was in Asia, I lived in Asia for 2 years, always had geckos around. Don't know where they came from, where they went, what they did. But all I knew is that they walked upside down on ceilings and glass, right? How do they do that? They don't have anything sticky on their feet. They have nanostructures on their foot pads. For 30 years, scientists have been trying to figure out how to replicate those. Well, finally, these guys at UMass Amherst figured out how to replicate the structure of a gecko's foot pad to create a dry adhesive. See this television set here? This is being suspended by that brown tab up there. That brown tab is made from that material and it's stuck to the wall and it's holding it. Is that amazing? Okay, I said everybody who wants to be a nano innovation champion must read science fiction or at least watch some movies. So when your son or daughter or friend or girlfriend or boyfriend says, let's go see the robot movie, don't say, oh, I don't want to see that. Let them go, okay? Because that's how you become a nano innovator. An innovator. So look at this. There's the Borg. Remember the Borg? That was pretty creepy when it first came out, right? Oh no, the Borg. And then that's actually a Borg type device that was developed. And finally we had Google Glass. Google Glass never caught on, but they're re-engineering it and trying to find a way for it to catch on and trying to reconfigure the form factor. See this, Captain Kirk? Here's Bill Shatner, who just signed my picture. Thank you, Bill. And there is the Star Trek tricorder. Guess what? In January or February, the XPRIZE Foundation is going to pick the winners from 7 finalists who developed a medical-type tricorder that can diagnose 15 medical conditions. That was the requirement. They're going to spread $10 million around those winners. Qualcomm is putting up the money. And if you go to xprize.org, you will see the finalists described, and you can read about them. But that tricorder is actually becoming a reality. And they issued a tricorder challenge, and they've been working on it for 3 years. And you can see some of the prototypes there. They're very cool. I said before, Lexus has this levitation hoverboard from like Back to the Future. That's pretty cool. How many of you have seen superheroes in movies with exoskeletons? You know, they all have these exoskeletons. They go, and then they try to destroy each other. Well, there's Mickey Rourke in a movie. Here's a real soldier using the Lockheed Martin Hulk exoskeleton. Allows him to carry 300 pounds and run, and it doesn't weigh him down at all. We're going to be extending the capabilities of soldiers as we go forward, and as a former soldier myself, I think that's pretty neat. God knows what everybody's developing that's going to surprise. The next war, we always have a war where people just surprise each other, right? In Iraq, we had a war where the United States shocked Iraq in the first Iraq war by showing that we can fight exclusively at night. We didn't even fight in the daytime. All their soldiers were sleeping when we were attacking them. It was pretty unfair, but it was successful. By the second Iraq war, all the veterans from Vietnam and the Iraq War No. 1 who subscribed to General Norman Schwarzkopf's edict, let the other guy die for his country if he wants to, they had all retired or gone their various ways. And the new generation were kind of martinets who said, well, we have to have like 5% have to die, and that's just too bad. And so we'll let the soldiers keep driving on the roads where the IEDs are blowing them up. And that's a travesty. But, you know, social and military and political will and perspectives play an important role if the technology is used or misused. Norman Schwarzkopf, in the Second Iraq War, the first time some poor soldier had their limbs blown off by an IED, they would have said, everybody's traveling by helicopter until we fix this. But unfortunately, the guys who were running Iraq didn't. And I'll make a political statement. Instead of leaving 3,000 soldiers behind to guard Iraq and prevent an ISIS from developing there, those same guys who were making those stupid decisions about IEDs and things, they pulled all the troops out and left ISIS to grow into kind of a weird, nefarious organization. So that's the relationship. Your decision making and technology go hand in hand. And if you don't use it right, or if you don't use it, or if you use it wrong, I mean, we could have been flying helicopters the last 10 years and saved 5,000 to 10,000 people from being maimed by IEDs. So anyway, but here's some things that people are going to be using, not only in future wars, but okay. Who do you think Lockheed was thinking when they made the Hulk to fight in war that they could help this young lady who was an Olympic ski champion who got paralyzed in a tragic accident? Do you think they were thinking they would let her help her walk? Some of the best innovations that we use in society today came from wars. That's weird, but it's true. Doesn't mean we should have more wars. This is a slide that explains the XPRIZE Foundation, and these are some of the actual prototypes. One of them uses a cell phone. One of them looks like a little disc. They all have different looks. But their purpose is to minimally invasively diagnose 15 medical conditions and statistics. By the way, one of the rules of that, it has to be usable by the patient. It can't be just administered by a doctor. That's pretty cool. So anyway, I'm going to leave you with my favorite. So I like to have a saying in every talk. This is my favorite one of all that I've ever used. This is from Harry Potter. Professor Dumbledore looks at Harry Potter at one point in this movie, Harry Potter and the Chamber of Secrets, and he says, "What distinguishes us is not our power or our ability, but the choices we make." So I would just urge everybody in this room, inspire yourself to make bold, creative choices. Keep asking what's needed, what's possible, what's wrong. Make bold choices, make progress every day, and help change the world.
Công ty Tân Đại Dương là một trong những công ty du học đầu tiên và hàng đầu tại Việt Nam, được thành lập bởi đội ngũ các nhà quản lý và tư vấn du học có nhiều năm kinh nghiệm trong ngành giáo dục cũng như được tu nghiệp và đào tạo ở nước ngoài. Với hơn 10 năm kinh nghiệm, Tân Đại Dương tự hào là nhà tư vấn du học chuyên nghiệp cho các du học sinh tại các nước trên thế giới, đặc biệt là Mỹ, Úc, Singapore, Anh Quốc, Hà Lan, Thụy Sĩ, v.v. Cùng với đội ngũ tư vấn viên chuyên nghiệp, chúng tôi cung cấp các dịch vụ uy tín và trọn gói cho ngành du học du lịch Mỹ, bao gồm xử lý trọn bộ hồ sơ đi Mỹ từ A đến Z, kể cả các hồ sơ khó, đã từng rớt visa hoặc không đủ tài chính. Tư vấn chọn trường tại tất cả các tiểu bang ở Mỹ, chúng tôi tự hào là đại diện chính thức của hàng trăm trường đại học cao đẳng, trung học phổ thông tại Mỹ. Hướng dẫn các thủ tục xin visa, chứng minh tài chính, hướng dẫn điền form, dạy phỏng vấn du học, du lịch Mỹ. Khai giảng hàng tháng các lớp học phỏng vấn, đảm bảo cho học sinh có được sự tự tin trả lời được mọi câu hỏi của lãnh sự quán. Đặt vé máy bay, sắp xếp nhà ở, ký túc xá cho du học sinh. Với phương châm hoạt động là uy tín, chất lượng và mong muốn định hướng cho học sinh Việt Nam một nền giáo dục tiên tiến, môi trường học tập và sinh hoạt an toàn, Tân Đại Dương cam kết sẽ là người bạn đồng hành cùng học sinh Việt Nam trên đường tới chân trời tri thức. Mọi chi tiết xin liên hệ công ty Tân Đại Dương chuyên du học Mỹ, mặt tiền 148/1 Trần Quang Khải, phường Tân Định, quận Nhất, thành phố Hồ Chí Minh, điện thoại 0838484879, 0989006890, website www.tandaiduong.edu.